This is Terry Giove. Terry Giove is a results-driven entrepreneurial health care executive who thinks like an owner and is passionate about healthcare. It says it right on. She has 25 plus years of knowledge and expertise in healthcare. She started her career as a physical therapist and has had a series of management positions, owned her own physical therapy business, and has been working at Hallmark Healthcare System from 1998 to the present. She is currently the Vice President of Ambulatory Services.
That's outpatient stuff.
Outpatient stuff. It's like radiology.
Radiology, oncology services, rehab, diabetes, endocrinology.
Yes.
A lot of it.
Overseeing a variety of outpatient services. She graduated from Stanford University School of Medicine, California in 1982 with a Master of Arts degree in physical therapy and a concentration in education. She attended Bridgewater State University, then Bridgewater Ooh. State College. From 1976 to 1980, got her Bachelor of Science in Health, Physical Education, minor in Psychology, along with a teaching certificate K-12. She was a clinician and a group leader of CPDC during her time at Bridgewater, and currently volunteers with New England Disabled Sports, teaching skiing to people with a variety of disabilities. Please give a warm CPDC welcome to Terry Giove.
So, well, I want to thank you all for coming. I did sit in your seat many years ago before you were even born, and that's kind of scary. I don't look it, right? So, but before you were even born, and I know what it's like to get up at Saturday morning at 6:30, 7 o'clock and sit here and say, but as I was talking to Liz earlier, you know, I said, so how does it feel to get up? She's like, you know, it's hard, but basically once you start playing with the kids, it's all worth it. So thank you for what you do. What you do is so special and so important. And for me, when I was a clinician, I came to Bridgewater State College to be a teacher. I did get my teaching degree, but 1 year, I think it was my junior year, I worked with a girl, 13-year-old girl with CP. She had had, at her young age of 13, over 11 synovectomies. And she came in every week smiling, happy, and with such zest for life. And it changed me, and it changed what I wanted to do. And that's why I decided to become a physical therapist, because of, you know, my experience here. So it basically changed my life and changed the course of my career. So basically, you know, you're doing a good thing, but something really good could happen to you. So it goes both ways. And that's kind of part of the balance of life. And that's what we're going to talk about today, is balance. And I am going to bring it from a holistic, big picture area to down to the physicality of balance. And our friend here who, Billy? Who tripped, lost his balance while taking out the trash and ended up with a knee problem. So balance and posture is really, really important in your life, even though at your age of 18 to 20, whatever you are right now, it doesn't seem so, but it really is. So that's what we're going to talk about. And at any point, if you have questions, I'm going to keep the lights up high so I can see if anyone's sleeping, then I'll call you out. but also, you know, because I want it to be interactive, and if you ever have a question during it, feel free to raise your hand and stop me, okay? So basically, I have been lecturing about scoliosis here for over the past 10 to 15 years every other year, and Dr. Huber asked me to speak about scoliosis, and I said, well, I'd like to do something different. You know, I'd like to expand it a little bit, and so we will be talking about a little bit of scoliosis, because you will see a lot of kids with scoliosis if you work with them, both physically and as a teacher. But I do want to make it broader about posture and balance, your health, sport performance. Are there any phys ed majors in the room? Okay, special ed? Any other type of majors that you're really going to work with children? Early childhood, what kind? Someone shout one out.
Elementary ed.
Anything else? Okay. So you will come across this, one out of every 10 people. So there's people in this room that have scoliosis. Maybe not treatable, you didn't have to get treated for it, but your spine isn't really straight. So the agenda for today, basically, we're going to go over what posture and balance is. Okay, I want you to kind of understand that, how it's related to balance, your posture, how it's related to balance, and that's sitting, standing, running, biking, whatever it is you're doing. The medical concerns about scoliosis, let have you learn a little bit about scoliosis, if you don't know it already. How it's all related to movement, recreation, and sport. Why it's important to you, both personally, for yourselves, and professionally with what you do with children and adults. So when you look at posture, basically, and you know, this kid is a little bit exaggerated, but the first one, did you ever see someone who kind of slumps back, like, and you feel like if you just like pushed on them, they'd fall over? And the second one, that you know, someone with their butts kind of out, the stomachs, you know, sometimes when they're older too, you really accentuates that. And the older people, you start to see them like this, and then they look down because they're afraid they're going to trip, and then you see those big humps on the back of their neck. Did you ever see that? Those big humps. It's called a Dowager's hump, and people aren't born with that. There's one law I learned here at Bridgewater State, which was Wolf's Law, and Wolf's Law states that bone grows according to the forces that are put upon it. So if I'm like this all the time, and my spine is like this, and it's not supposed to be that way, the bones start to grow in an unnatural way. And that's how, if you have, you know, grandmothers or grandfathers, if you're seeing them and they're like this all the time, you know, tell them to bring it up, because basically they will get one of those humps. And it gets very, very painful. Dowager's hump. Remember that Wolf's Law will treat you well. Bone grows according to the forces placed upon it. And so when you look at good posture, you know, it doesn't have to be military, but you see the ears. The ears are in alignment with the shoulder, right in the middle of the shoulder, going through right through the middle of the hips, down to the knee, into the middle of the foot. Okay, so that's good posture. When you're walking, if you're looking down like this and seeing your feet, your head's too far forward. You should be able to just like look ahead of you about 10, 15 feet, have your chin kind of high, and walk through life that way. Again, you're 18, 19 years old, doesn't seem to matter. But 85% of American people at some point come see people like me for low back pain. 85% have medical treatment for back pain. And they were all at one point your age and, you know, with no problems whatsoever. But it's kind of like the straw that broke the camel's back. If you keep abusing your body in certain ways, it eventually catches up to you. So you don't want to be one of those 85%. Any questions on that? Lordosis and kyphosis are the two main things you'll see in that sagittal plane, looking that way, versus the frontal plane, which is scoliosis is in, that people have problems with. Lordosis, again, that increased curvature of the spine, the butt sticks out, and the kyphosis, this kind of thing that causes all kinds of problems for people's upper back and neck. So balance. So that was posture, just kind of basics about posture, standing posture. We'll get into posture and movement and sitting later. But when you think about balance, you know, balance overall, the big picture, you have to balance your school life, your studying, your partying. I'm sure, like, you had to make decisions last night, right? Am I going to party? Am I going to go to bed earlier? Or I'll do a little bit of both, because you had to be here really early and alert today. You know, so when you're out of school, like Ryan said, you know, you have to balance your kids' life, your married life, of your, you know, your friends, your relatives. Balance is in everything. Within yourself, there's your psychological balance, emotional balance, physical balance. So balance is very, very pervasive. It's everything. It's everywhere. And also, when you think about physical balance, it's static, but it's also dynamic. So now that you're all sitting and comfortable, I want you all to stand up. And just where you're at, I think everyone has a flat surface. What I want you to do is just keep your eyes open and just balance on one foot. And just see if you can just hold it. This is static balance. Now go to the other foot. Don't hold on to the chair, I'm seeing that. Okay. All right, so now the foot that you felt most comfortable with, because everyone is like, you know, right-legged or left-legged, I want you to stand on that foot, and then I want you to close your eyes. Okay. Okay, so that now this is just static, okay? Static. Closing your eyes and balancing. It's harder. Okay, so when you think about a blind person, I checked the schedule, and I think in a few weeks you're going to have someone here from Perkins to talk to you about, you know, the blind. And it is such a challenge when you're not totally physically, let's call it a normie, right, to have to go through life and do these simple things, static balance. Now you think you put motion into it, and it's a lot different. Okay, you can sit. So what is balance? I decided to look up in the dictionary and see what the definitions of balance were. And I got all these different definitions. I just added the life balance on it. That wasn't in the dictionary. But when you look at it, it's a equilibrium. And you saw that picture earlier of that scale. You know, balance is about equilibrium. And you can see that basically if you look at these definitions, I'm not going to read them to you, but there's balance about physicality, there's balance about emotional state, about staying calm under pressure. All of us have stress and pressure, right? And the way we deal with it is really important to our physical health, our own health and well-being. And I have a team of people that report to me. And in healthcare, it's really stressful and there's a lot of work. And I always tell my team, I teach them all this, and you may want to remember this one for yourself. I teach them the 24-hour rule. So if there is something that really bothers you and really upsets you, and maybe you feel is unfair, or you're kind of upset at someone, mad at someone, take 24 hours. Think about it. Think about it from all perspectives, not just your own, because we all see life through our own perception. And our perception is our own reality, you know. But just take a step back. Don't emote. Don't react. Take that 24 hours. And then have a measured, good approach to the problem. You know, the person or people or situation could be unfair. They could have done something that wasn't so nice. But instead of emoting and reacting to it, you know, you can be more, you know, just calm about it. Helps the situation, but it, most of all, it helps you. Because those negative emotions and those stressful, negative stress isn't good for you. Again, it's all keeping in the balance or homeostasis. So any questions on what balance is and how pervasive it is for your life? So basically, this is an Olympian. This is the past Olympics. You know, this is the long jump. There are, you know, every single motion in that long jump is coached and coached over and over and over again. And this person has to just keep in touch with their forward momentum. You know, when they hit the ground, basically, that tape measure goes from the place where they took off to the closest point of bodily contact in that sand. So that person has to make sure that they catapult themselves forward, too, and not lose their balance and go backwards. So for sport, the difference between an Olympian and just someone who's good or someone who's great or someone who makes the team or doesn't make the team or, you know, basically performs at their ability, it all starts with posture and balance because that's your foundation. And anything in life that you do, you first want to set a firm foundation. And once you get the foundation down, then you go to the higher levels, like a pyramid. You know, eye-hand coordination, agility, you know, strength, all those different things that you have to work on to become a well-tuned athlete, if that's your passion, you know, or just going through life and being recreational. And also working with the students and teaching. You always want to start, like, what's the basics? When, as a physical therapist, you know, people come to me, they have multiple problems. They may be complaining, oh, my neck hurts, but I have to look at them, evaluate them. That's like peeling an onion. You know, so basically the outer layers, I just deal with those first. But you go deeper, deeper into the core to find the root cause problem, and then you solve it. And a lot of times it's biomechanics. It's the way they sit, the way they stand, the way they move through life that cause these problems. So scoliosis. Earlier I said you can look at the sagittal plane. That's when we looked at posture. And then this is the frontal plane. You know, so when you look at somebody's back like that and you see that curve, there's an S curve. Anyone here have physics yet? No, huh? Well, Newton has three laws. What's the third law? Yes, so every action has an equal and opposite reaction. In physical world, that's true. It's also in the emotional world, the social world. Think about what I talked about before, that, you know, someone may do something and you get angry and maybe you just, you react and emote, and it kind of goes back and forth, back and forth. So every action has an equal and opposite reaction. So most curves in the spine are an S curve, because the body has to stay in equilibrium. And if you see her shoulders, you can see they're pretty level, even though you can see that there's hardly no space there, because that's the convex side of that curve, versus that, look at that big space there. So that's one of the things you look at when you look at someone with scoliosis, the symmetry. And all of us, in order to maintain our balance, have to have our eyes in horizontal. So if our back was like this, we'll do anything to make sure that our eyes are in this plane, because we won't be able to walk, we'll have total vertigo, and it'll just be a nightmare. You'd be totally dizzy all the time. So the body it's an amazing thing, the human body, but it will adjust and adapt to have you be able to function as well as possible. So in this gentleman, he has what's called a C curve to the left, and you can also see the scapula right there sticking out, and on her too, on the side of the convex side is the outside, concave is on the inside, so you can see it sticks out. Now somewhere in his neck, or also in his low back here, there's joints, and he will compensate there to keep that head and keep those eyes in that horizontal plane. So when you're seeing, you know, some of your students and everything, how it relates to clinic, look. Check out the different physical disabilities and where their head is in space. And when you see the people that, they probably don't come here, but that are so kind of out of it and everything and can't really move, those are the ones that you see kind of like this, because they just can't get that head up to horizontal and have those eyes be on that plane. Make sense? So types of scoliosis. Idiopathic is the most common. It happens mostly with adolescents. 80% of scoliosis is idiopathic. Etiology unknown. Don't know why it happens. There's also pathic or neuromuscular. That's conditions like CP, spina bifida, muscular dystrophy. You probably see all those here. Congenital. Very rare, happens in utero, so the baby's actually born with scoliosis. It's very, very rare. And the last is adult or degenerative, and that is basically with an older person, 60, 70 years old, who their spine has adapted or changed or degenerated because of their movement patterns. So you can kind of bring it on yourself. So idiopathic, again, that's the most common, 80%. And there's four types of it, and the third type, which is adolescent, that's the most common. So between 10 and 18, during the growth spurt. Interesting, girls and guys, same incidence, but girls tend to have their curve progress more, requiring treatment. So somewhere, hormones have to be involved. They can't figure it out yet, but I would say logically it would make sense that hormones come into play of why the girls are progressing more. So again, most common, and what happens during when the scoliosis starts is usually there's 1 degree of progression. It keeps getting worse and worse per month. So this problem starts and it becomes pretty, you know, people become aware of it pretty soon. And 10% of school-age children have scoliosis or some degree of it. That's 1 in 10. So what are there, about 80 people in this room? So by statistics, about 8 people have some type of scoliosis. And 2 to 3 out of 1,000 actually need some kind of treatment, and 1 out of 1,000 need surgery because it's so severe. Again, I told you the type of curves. There's the C curve, but remember that there's compensation somewhere, one of the key joints, to keep that head in the horizontal plane. And the more common is the S-shaped curve, where there's compensation within the spine itself, so you can see that S. And it usually, I don't know why, most are common to the right, with the apex of the curve at about T8, which is just below the nipple line. So that's what you most commonly see when you look for scoliosis. So to screen for it is really pretty easy. You know, you basically have the person stand in front of you, and you're teaching special ed now, right, Ryan?
Right.
Do you have any kids in your classes that you know of that have scoliosis?
Oh, definitely. That's what I think it's
How are they being treated?
With physical therapists, and they have special times, like during the day, during the week, maybe 3 times a week that they'll meet individually, like a pull out or something, like physical therapist, for like an hour each time, to address them, and this home programs and stuff too.
Any braces or anything?
I believe that there are some braces. I don't have any students that have braces, but I know through the school that there definitely are a couple of students that have braces.
And how do they find out these kids have scoliosis?
Probably through screening. A lot of these students have severe disabilities, so a lot of them are in the doctors at an early age from the time they're born. So it's picked up pretty quickly. But some students who came to us from public schools, definitely through screening in public schools.
Right. In screening for scoliosis is mandatory in Massachusetts. And it's really fast to be able to do. So, you know, the physician or nurse or whoever who is doing the screening, they just look at the patient, look at the student, and look at for symmetry of the shoulders, the hips. Then they have them turn, and they stay behind them. They do what's called the Adams forward bend test. And basically, all you have them do is just like go forward, and then you look for what's called that rib hump. Remember I showed you the scapula sticks out on one side? As you bend forward, it becomes very, very obvious. Any of you could pick this up. Okay, it's not hard to see it. So you just look, if their rib hub wasn't there, it would be straight across. You would see symmetry. Again, balance, symmetry, balance. You know, it all comes down to that, you know, basic state of equilibrium. So again, 1 in 10 people have scoliosis. That's why it's important to you, because you are going to come across it a lot. You'll come across it in clinic. And 2 to 3%, as I said, will need some kind of treatment, and 1 out of 1,000, surgery. So basically, what are the treatment options? First is to just kind of leave it alone. Sometimes the scoliosis is very, very mild. It's not going to impede someone's growth and everything. It may just be a couple degrees, and you just watch it and just see if there's a intense progression. Bracing is the second type of option. Surgery for severe. And the goal of the treatment is to stop the progression of the curve. Now, as Ryan said, there's also physical therapy associated with it, but physical therapy won't stop the progression of the curve. I mean, basically, if someone has it and the curve is stable, also there's some problems where on that convex side, so on this side of the convex, the muscles get stretched out and they're weak, and on this side, on the concave side, they're tight. So what you want to do, what the physical therapist does, is strengthen the side that's stretched out and stretches the side that's really tight to try to, again, get that equilibrium of balance for the person. So they can help, and they can help maintain, and make the person more comfortable, but PT won't stop the progression of the curve, unfortunately. Yes?
Do you find with older people, like, they have more surgeries? Like, is it something that, like, progresses? So if you have it at a young age, you're, like, it's going to get worse when you're older? Or is it something that you can just stop?
Well, most of the progression of the curve, great question, most of the progression of the curve happens between that 10 and 18,
yeah.
And then it levels off and that during that growth spurt. So most of the surgeries that happen are usually in younger people because it's progressing so quickly. And what they do with the surgery is there's a thing called a Harrington rod. Have you ever heard of that? So they'll put a rod in there, or they may not put the rod, because the more levels that they stop, the less motion the person can have. And again, every action has an equal and opposite reaction, right? So if my spine is like this straight for like 12 levels, I'm going to have hypermobility somewhere else. You know, it's just going to happen. So they have little clamps now that they put. You know, I should have brought my spine with me, but there's little transverse processes on each side, and they bolt them together, you know, and sometimes don't put the rod in, you know, or sometimes they do. And the less levels you can do it, the better for the person. Yes?
Now, how much does that limit your mobility? Like, if they put in, like, say, a rod, like, straight up, would you not, like, is there any, I guess, would you not be able to walk, like, normally, or how does that?
Right, so it depends how many levels of the spine that they put the rod in. So, you know, the C spine you have about, you know, 6, 7, thoracic you have 12, lumbar you have 5. So usually the rod would go between the thoracic and the beginning of the cervical area, or just the thoracic area. So you'd still be able to bend from the waist, because the hips aren't even part of the spine. Okay, so you can bend forward this way and use the spine, or you can put your spine totally straight and bend from here. So you could still move, you could still walk, but your motion this way would be really limited. Your twisting would be limited. So you could still function. But the thing is, the more levels that they have immobile, the levels that are below and above are going to be more mobile, hyper mobile, and then you get problems with that. So everything you do, you know, there's going to be an issue. Same thing with chemistry, a drug, you know, prescription drug abuse, right, is like rampant. Anything that you put in your system, there's an equal and opposite reaction somewhere else. You know, one of the guys that I saw while I was here at Bridgewater State, he started football, and he had this coach, and he came back, and he said, my body's a temple. You know, so basically, you know, the coach really influenced him. His body was a temple, and he was really fastidious about anything he put in his body. He wore off after a while, but, I mean, so, so yes.
My brother has a severe case of kyphosis, yeah. And through, like, the screenings for scoliosis, are they able to see start happening, because he was never referred to a doctor or anything throughout, you know.
He's 15. How old was he when first started to see it?
Well, my mom was the first one who started to notice there was like a hump on his back.
Yeah.
And we just went to the doctor last year, and he has to have surgery this summer because it's pretty severe. But through all the screenings, like from, you know, elementary up until now, he was never referred. Are they able to see that happening at an earlier state? Like, I don't know how that happened, how he went through.
Right, it's not as visible as the scoliosis is, but basically, you know, with those pictures we first had, you'd see someone like this. And if they don't have the compensation curve, because the curve of your spine, you know, from this way, the neck goes like that, the back naturally goes out, and then the low back, the lumbar area comes back in. And I do have a picture of a skeleton, we'll get back to this. But sometimes it's just more. And then what happens over time, Wolf's Law, okay, it could be minor, but then the person more and more and more. Stand up again. Okay, so stand up just straight and try to do, like that picture you saw, ears, shoulders, hips, everything in alignment. Okay, so I basically, what I'm going to do now, and you're going to watch me, and then you're going to do it, is I'm just going to put my head forward and change my posture and get into a sort of a kyphotic posture and watch what happens with my body. Okay, I'm just going to do this really slow, and I am not going to do anything except let nature do it. Did you see that? So what happens is, as I bring my neck forward and everything, what happens is now gravity is pulling me down. And all of these muscles here have to stop me. And I had to, like, then stop myself from just falling forward. So what I want you to do is just stand up straight, get good posture, shut your eyes, and then just bring your neck forward and just feel what happens to your body. You feel that? Okay, you can sit down. So your brother, okay, probably, you know, with a little bit of kyphosis, you know, didn't adjust. Maybe he wasn't taught. No one picked it up. So he didn't, you know, make some compensations to keep himself like this and was like this. And then because of Wolf's Law, it got worse and worse and worse. And then his head, and then the big hump. So, yeah, so there's, and that's why it's important to you all, you know. I mean, because there's little things, you know, as we go forward that can affect you as you age. Wasn't so a big deal when he was 18, 19, but now he's 50 and needs surgery. So these are some of the braces. I mean, basically our society is moving towards less is better, right? Surgeries for ACL. Anyone have an ACL tear? Okay. So surgeries used to be, you know, halfway down your leg, over here, everything open. The rehabilitation was horrible, months and months. Now they do everything through a scope, boom, boom, 45 minutes, you're done, right? So everything is less intervention. So the Milwaukee-based brace was one of the first, and you can see they're all named after their states, like doctors name things after themselves, but you don't see these anymore. I mean, this was back in the day. Then they have moldable braces, like the Boston brace, that are molded to the person. If you have to wear a brace, it's not fun. We're talking about 23 hours a day. You know, you get to take it off to shower or something like that. You have to sleep in it. It's horrible.
I've taken mine off to go to sleep, actually.
Yeah, see, he's just talking about a knee brace here, not one of these things for a spine, right? He has that thing and it's uncomfortable.
The inside of the child's tumor looks like the inside of this one.
Right. It's uncomfortable, right?
Yes.
Because you lost your balance, see? So... and the Charleston that has Velcro so it can come off, and now they also have a brace that's built for motion to allow someone to move. So straps, you know how this taping for athletes, you see all those big things that tape on them to hold their musculature and different things in different ways. You saw a lot of it at the Olympics if you watched it. So this is using strapping to try to help keep that progression of the curve at a minimum. Not as effective, but again, not as uncomfortable for the patient. Use more in mild cases than a severe. Yeah.
This just kind of like popped into my head, but like with the way that the world's like changing and everything, a lot of people are doing a lot more sitting these days than like being up and physically active and everything. Do you see something like this becoming like available to like the general public in the future for like, you know, people spend 10, 12 hours a day sitting down in like a chair or something like that and they start to form like back problems? Would something mm-hmm. like that possibly be available to like help them with back problems? Or?
Well, let's talk about ergonomics. I'm just going to skip past this and go to this. So basically, you know, what Ryan's bringing up is sitting in an everyday life. And I was at a seminar a couple of weeks ago. And I walked by an office, and I saw a guy sitting on one of the the plyo balls, a nice big one, and he was at his computer. And so there he was doing his core strengthening. You guys know what core strengthening is? So he's doing his core strengthening. He's on his ball, and he's working. Perfect. Great posture. So when you think about if you have to sit all day and you're in front of a computer, there's key things in this. 90-90, hips, knees, and 90 degrees. Feet flat on the floor. They shouldn't be dangling. Your knees shouldn't be up near your chest. Okay, so this is nice posture, and you can see the alignment. You're sitting, but you're still in alignment. And you see the eyes level with the top of the screen. How many of you have iPads and, you know, different things? You're like this with your computer all the time. You're all going to end up with Dowager's humps if you keep doing that all the time. You need to, it's really important that when you're studying and doing stuff, that you maintain this. You may not think it's important now, but trust me, for years and years, okay, if you keep doing that, it will take a toll on you. Is that a hand, or are you just having fun over there?
Oh, I was talking about this. My chiropractor keeps telling me that I should get a computer that comes from, that hangs down, so that I would be looking forward as opposed to looking down at something all the time.
Yeah, the looking down things, guys, really, really important for all of you, And one thing. So there's some people that actually leave their desk and they have treadmills with computer stations on them, like they have TVs, and they go and they can like work while they're walking. on the balls, you know, to keep nice posture and doing your workout while you're working. So people who have to sit a lot for work, there's different ways you can do that. But ergonomics, the braces, I would say no, people aren't going to go through all that. You know, there's easier, simpler things you can do. So let me just back up. Okay. So again, I put the who cares because, again, you know, I'm trying to just let you know that although, you know, you may feel like, you know, I had Chris Reeve in there, like you may feel like it's not going to happen to me. You know, I'm good. I'm in good shape. You know, it will happen to you if you don't start good habits now. I had a truck driver once who lifted and twisted in a bad way. And he blew out a disc, severely hurt. And he said, well, I've been doing it this way for 20 years. And you know, I've lifted this way 1,000 of times. I'm like, yeah, and this was the time that broke the camel's back. You know, your body can only take so much abuse before it says enough. So for you guys, you're in your ability to, you know, basically in sitting and static poses and in dynamic physicality poses, what is good for you, what's good for your body, and we'll talk about that and also talk about what's good for your, you know, the students, the people that you work with, what's good for their body. I'm going to go through all these things, different motion and static. So again, Chris Reeve. You know, again, he was probably before your time, but has anyone seen the Superman movies with him in it? You know, I mean, he lost his balance. He was a great rider, lost his balance, got thrown off a horse. It was a C2 quad, unfortunately passed away, fought a valiant fight, you know, wanted to really, he was, you know, doing research to try to regenerate and repair nerves that were torn in the spinal column. Didn't get there. We still haven't gotten there. Someday we might. I'm not sure in my lifetime, maybe yours. But we're not. All of us are flesh and bone, and none of us are indestructible. None of us. And it's important to be careful with yourself. And if you could take back that second when you fell, right, you would, you know, and you redo it and think, oh, maybe I was careless for a second, you know, you could take that back and, you know.
I wouldn't be wearing this right now. The activities here.
Right, he had to sit in the front row because he had to put his leg out versus being back there, right? So lifting, this one is important for you guys. Shoveling, lifting. These muscles in your back are really, really small. They're not built to lift. They're only built to keep your spine erect. Here's the picture I was telling you about the skeleton. Okay, so your skeleton is built to keep you basically standing up straight like this with hardly no effort on your part. It's when you start, you know, bad postures when your muscles are doing all kinds of things. And so these muscles in your legs, your quads, your hams, you know, they're built to lift. They're big, they're strong, okay? That's what they're built for. So you want to make sure that when you're lifting, that you're lifting with your back straight and you bend here, not from your back and lift that thing up. You do it enough, you're gonna be hurt. You're gonna be one of those 85%. 85% is a lot of people. That's what keeps physical therapists in business. So when you think about the lifting with this guy, he could do a lot of damage, okay? I mean, a lot of damage. And you can see that same posture, the back is straight. He's using his legs, his quads, and his hams to do that deadlift. To get that thing up there. Why they do it, I don't know, but he wants to do it. So running is a process of falling and catching yourself. Okay, as we went forward like this, we found that we see gravity is pulling us, one of Newton's laws. Okay, so gravity is pulling us down. So when you run, you want to keep your spine in alignment. You want to fall and catch yourself. You're going to run into the future. Same thing with skiing. You ski into the future. You don't hold yourself back or lean back, okay, because basically it's not efficient motion. You're going backwards versus forwards, and you're running forwards, not backwards. So, like, this is a really bad way to run. It's inefficient, and you'll hurt himself. This guy, good. And for you guys with these kids, your responsibility, okay, is to make sure that you chunk things in little bits so these kids have success. Because you're dealing, again, with balance, you're dealing with their self-esteem, their ability to be able to do something, to have fun, you know, to have enjoyment, and to have little successes in life. And that's why you're probably all here, because it makes you feel good, right? To help someone else, it makes you feel good, it's something you want to do. And always remember to chunk things down in little bits for them so they can be able to get to this point where they can play and recreate and dance in a way that's fun for them and they're feeling some success. We all want to feel good about what we do. So here she is, again, some of the same postures. Remember we talked about the posture flying through the air. You can see that same arm in the air. There are mechanics, there are ways to do things, okay, that will give you the maximal performance. Again, starting with the foundation of balance. So now you have people with disabilities. Now it's a whole other world, right? It's hard enough having everything, your arms, your legs, your sight, and being able to be in balance, you know, in this life, both statically and dynamically. Now we have basically the kids that you are working with now are all going to become adults. You know, so whether they're an amputee, if they're a wounded warrior and they lost their legs from, you know, one of those bombs that go off, you know, or they're blind from birth, or they have diabetes and they end up blind, or they're a quad or paraplegic because of an accident. And usually it's the really high athletic people who take risks who end up, you know, in these wheelchairs because in a moment in time somehow they lost their balance. This is Whistler Peak, where the Olympics were last year, and this is called the saddle right here, and I skied down that. So I'm a professional ski instructor. I've worked at Loon for 25 years, teaching people with disabilities how to ski. Teaching normies is easy, but teaching people with disabilities gives you a whole other range of how you have to adapt to get down the mountain. And many people who ski, their first thing is to lean backwards, and we talked about that. No, you want to ski into the future. You want to go forward like that runner, okay, because that's going to keep you in on balance over your skis. And if you don't have good balance, you can't get down something like this. And right about here on Whistler Peak was the beginning of the downhill and Super G Olympic runs. And what a lot of people don't know is that after the Olympics were over, those 2 weeks, then all the people with disabilities come in. And there's 2 weeks of the Paralympics. And these people that you see in the wheelchairs and something like that, they all go down those same exact runs as those top-notch, incredible athletes, and usually at the same speeds. We don't get to see this on TV and everything, but it is pretty amazing. And you can imagine that without great balance, that's called a monoski, that these people could not even go 2 feet, never mind down a mountain that I just showed you. And this is, it says Caustic Cup on this. This is, we have an annual race for our students in the program. The program started about 25 years ago, and there was 5 of us that started it. In the first year, we did 40 lessons. Now there's over 210 instructors, and we do about 3,500 lessons in a year. There's a lot of people with disabilities out there that need our help. And so we have a race every year, so whether you're blind or CP or you're 4 years old or you're 40, you can, for that day, race through the gates and feel that measure of success. And to have them race, they love it. They really get just so much joy from it. And so you guys come to Loon every year. I connected the two programs about 12 years ago. And a group of you, have any of you here that went there last year? That's right, I remember you. Awesome. So it's a great program, and every year I tell Sheila, I want you guys to be able to ski and actually take a lesson with us. So I'm going to try to work on that, take a ski lesson, maybe with some of the equipment. But and also, we have grown. The program now is, it started off as a ski school. And now in the winter, we do skiing, snowshoeing, riding, snowboarding. And in the summer, it's now year-round, we do hiking, cycling, water skiing, knee boarding, kayaking, fishing, golfing, and there's going to be an intern from this program here next year. Is the person in the room? Ha. Ah. So when are you going to go? Can you tell us a little bit about that? And tell me your name.
My name's Nate. I'm going to go May, I think the week right after school, to like August, and next summer.
So you're going to be there all summer?
Yeah.
Fantastic. That's great. Maybe you can give a little presentation to the clinic about your internship at one of these lectures next year. That would be a really good thing. So, my final thought, I am going to read this to you about balance. Just as your car runs more smoothly and requires less energy to go faster and farther when the wheels are in perfect alignment, you perform better your thoughts, feelings, emotions, goals, and values are in balance. So please just remember about balance. It's important for you. It's important for the kids. And I'll take any questions you'd like. And thank you for your attention. You've been wonderful. And you are all wonderful. I really appreciate what you do. Someone has the first one. Come on.
I guess I'll be the one.
There you go, Ryan.
just a question, like relating to the clinic, with scoliosis and with balance in general, what are some things that we can do to work with the children to improve their balance, or if they have scoliosis, like any of those issues, what are things we can directly do in the clinic to help them with that?
Okay. The first thing you should all do is watch the way the kid either walks in or wheels in. You know, do you have a lot of kids on wheelchairs?
Yeah, quite a few, probably half a dozen, maybe 8 or 9.
Okay, so the first thing is to watch the way they walk in, look at their posture, watch them in their wheelchair, you know, see how they, you know, if they sit up straight, do they have good, you know, motor control of their thoracic area, and just use that as, you know, a basis for how you're going to work with them. Watch the way they walk. If they're walking like this, you know, look at what's tight, look at you know, their shoulder height. Those kind of things, so you can assess, okay, are they going to have a problem with balance? You know, a kid with CP who's on, you know, with crutches is like this, he's going to have a problem with balance, right? And you certainly, if they're tight, you know, with CP, basically the muscles that flex get tight, so that, you know, for the legs, that's the hamstrings, and the Achilles get tight, the biceps get tight, and the extensors, the things that go like this, are loose. So the last thing you want to do, just so you know, for a physical therapist to tell you this, is try to get them in the weight room and strengthen the hamstrings and you know, strengthen the biceps, you know, and do weights. The last thing you want to do, because that you're just feeding into their disability, you know, versus, you know, stretching. Not that you'd want to try to be stretching them and doing, you know, but you just want to be aware of some of these things, and it just depends on the child. But utilize, you know, some of the skills that you have in your brain to know about, you know, things need to be in balance. If someone walks in like this, you know, there's going to be an issue. You know, so how to work on them and try to get this to this. And if someone, you see one of your students is slumping over or walks like this, tell them, hey, chin up. You know what? Keep your eyes up. You know, just little things. You know, just taking the basics, that basic foundation of what good posture is. And try to just give them some feedback to help them out with that. Yes?
I have a question. So as scoliosis progresses, does that affect the transmission of nerve impulses from different parts of the body, or is it just the skeletal structure that affects?
So basically, great question. The nerves from the spine all come out of each level. Okay, so if you have a curve like this, you bet some nerves are going to get compressed. And if they get compressed too long, first it gets numbness, tingling. You know, people have low back pain, they say they have numbness and tingling. That's because that, like, either the disc is out or something is pressing on the nerve. So if they have compression on the nerve, they can have numbness and tingling. If it's severe and keeps going for a long time, you can have motor problems. So there's two types of nerves, right? Afferent and efferent. So afferent is what you feel, efferent is for motion. Okay, so if your efferent nerves get affected because of intense pressure and, you know, prolonged, if I go like this for a long time, doesn't hurt right now, but if I kept this for an hour ago, I would injure myself. So prolonged pressure like that will injure the nerves, and will injure their ability to feel and also to move. Afferent, afferent. You went like this about that. Were you taking neuroanatomy or something? So you know. Yes.
If you walk like hunched over, you said, and you get that like bump, mm-hmm. how long would it take it to grow? Would it take years?
It's a slow progression. Anyone ever have a heel spur? Okay, heel spur. So basically, you know, a heel spur is say you have a flat foot, you know, and you're always running, and you don't have nice orthotics or good athletic shoes that really support. Okay, so you're a runner, and every day you go out there, you do 5-6 miles, and boom, boom, boom. And basically what happens is your foot goes down like that. There's a it's called plantar fascia, and it's pulling on the calcaneus. It's pulling, 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 pulling. Gradually, after all that repetition, boom, the heel spur is there, because bone grows according to the forces put upon it. Right, so the problem isn't the heel spur. The problem is the flat feet and the orthotics that you don't have that causes it. So you can treat the injury, the heel spur, and get the inflammation down. But you need to get the orthotics and get the biomechanical evaluation to make sure it doesn't happen again. So if you haven't done that, then do that. Okay. So basically, it's gradual, and it depends on what you're doing. But it's also can be not so much reversible, but basically if you were starting to get the hump and you were, oh my God, you know, basically over time, you know, your posture will go back into the correct alignment if you haven't let it go on to like the point where your brother did. Yes?
So have you seen that towel things in like magazines a lot lately? It's like the roll towel and you put it like where your shoulder blades are, and if you like lay like that for a certain amount of time, like eventually it will go away.
Well, no, you know, remember, it's a force. So, I mean, you would have to lie on a hard surface, right? I mean,
yeah,
to
like, really lie on the floor and like,
right.
Roll a towel at a certain height and like put it where your shoulder blades are. And then eventually,
right, this way, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you know, it will help because it brings you back to where you're supposed to be. Because if you're like this, see, now you have that that thing and it brings you like this. So it will help, but you have to do it a lot. And you have to not then stand like this. You know, you have to, you know, really consciously use your muscles and your back, your rhomboids and everything to get up straight. And also, a rolled up towel is a wonderful thing for people that sit at computers. You know, what you brought up earlier. Roll up a towel, put it behind your low back, okay, because there's a natural space there, like with your foot that's flat, okay, put it there, and then you sit up and it helps you to stay up straight so you don't have to work at it. And keeps your posture better. Did you have a?
So I played field hockey for like 8 years.
Yeah.
So and you're consistently bent over, but does that like will that affect like with athletes will that affect you in the long run like when you get older?
Well, okay. So field hockey, you're in motion. Remember, you're running up and down the field, and then you're like this. But it depends on how you like this. You could be like this, not so good. You could be like this, better. Okay, so you want to try to keep your spine as flat as possible and bend from the hips. There's a big difference between this and this. And so, and with field hockey, you want to keep your head up, you know, so bending from the hips would be better, would be good, and it won't bother you. Yes?
So my brother often complains of, like, back pain because of the hump. Now, would the towel, would that help him, like, relieve some of his pain? Like, what are some ways that he can help the pain he's having?
You know, not being able to see him, it's hard, but the towel may help, but it depends on where his pain is, you know, and what other, you know, kind of reactions to that, that condition that he's had. But it's tough. You should try the towel because it'll help him stay up, stretching and strengthening the upper back and this area here would help him. What she said about the towel, like laying, that might help, you know, but if it's so far gone that he has surgery,
yeah,
you know, that's a tough one.
Yeah.
Yes?
They always say that everything in your body is, like, connected. If you have physical like bad posture, would that affect your mental like posture with the feelings and the emotions and vice versa, or not directly?
Well, if you're in pain, so if you have bad posture and it's affecting you, and I would say overall, yes, because when you think about the athlete, right, and the person who is the Olympian versus the person who's good, you know, again, it starts from that foundation. You know, if I'm standing like this in the outfield and a ball comes my way quickly, I may not reach it. But if I'm like this in the ready position, ready to spring, then I will. So basically, yes, I mean, it's really foundational. And there is a thing called fascia that wraps every single cell, every muscle, everything in your body. Chicken. Do you ever like have that film on chicken? Like sometimes you get a breast that doesn't have fat, but there's still that filmy thing on it, and you take that off because it's kind of gross. That's fascia. And fascia is all through your body. And if you just cut, if you just have a little cut on your hand or your knee or whatever, as it heals, you know, you see those little scars? Basically, the fascia gets tight. Every single thing you do to your body affects the rest of it. So that fascia gets pulled and tight, and it starts pulling on things. So yes, you know, it could affect your ability to concentrate and stay with something longer or be the best you can be because you're not at 100%. Some of it's subtle, some of it is just so, you know, obvious. But the subtleties are the things that I just wanted to impress upon you all, that if you're attentive to it now, you know, when you're 50, whatever, you won't have some of the problems that, that some other people have. Well, thank you. Those are all great questions. Have a great time. I'm a little jealous that you guys get to all do this now, and I don't. So have fun. Thank you.
Presenting the CPDC t-shirt in case you lost your other one.
Love it. I did it, but thank you. Every year it's great, and I wear them. I wear it with pride. Thank you
awesome.
So much.
Great.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you so much.